The Soul of Capitalism by William Greider, read by Peter Johnson. This new moment. First, we pause to acknowledge the ancestors. The discontents of present-day American life are real enough, but can seem quite trivial and self-indulgent when laid alongside the American past. Modern pressures lack the hard and often tragic bite of what earlier Americans commonly endured. Three or four generations ago, most Americans lived in dwellings that lacked indoor plumbing, not to mention electricity and central heating. Most families were tenants, not owners. Life was simpler, certainly, but also much shorter. Half of the children born in 1900 were dead by the age 40. In our time, 95% of the new babies will live to 40, and half will be still alive at 79. People, it is said, were more God-fearing in olden days, and probably so, since their lives were ruled by stark, random insecurities that dwarf our own. Bad weather that could destroy livelihoods, or abrupt waves of economic disorder. Unspeakably harsh working conditions and inadequate incomes. The blind cruelties of uncontrollable diseases. Parents regularly experienced the sudden death of small children, an event that no doubt encouraged faith in an afterlife, the promise of a heavenly reward. What would they make of us? Surrounded as we are by luxurious goods and plentiful variety, the profusion of entertainments and electronic machines that allow our minds to leap freely across time and space. The departed ancestors naturally would be astonished by the reckless speed of modern life and the hedonism. Their descendants are fabulously wealthy by comparison, bizarrely wealthy, and the ancestors might insist that even our poor people are rich in everyday comforts and exotic possessions. How can a child be truly poor who owns $125 sneakers and a Game Boy? Before there were designer labels, the distinctions of class status were recognized easily by all because they were delineated bluntly in terms of the most basic amenities. In 1918, only a third of laboring families had a bathroom in their dwellings, though often not hot water, while three-fourths of the salaried class enjoyed this new convenience of indoor plumbing. The peculiar social habits and artifacts of luxury Thorstein Veblen identified in the early 20th century as tribal markings of the leisure class have since become generalized throughout the population, though the leisure class still manages to distinguish itself with a higher order of conspicuous consumption. Our humble forebears might recognize a brave new cosmopolitanism in our everyday tastes. Episcopalians who eat Mexican food, truck drivers who vacation on Caribbean cruises. But they would perhaps also see us adrift in a sea of empty follies. One feels awe for the past, yet also estranged. It was so different. The extraordinary changes in American lives, especially lifespans that are now 25 or 30 years longer, are the universal bounty delivered by industrial capitalism during the last century and before. The deep transformation in living conditions and expectations was wrought by the wealth-creating processes of investment and production, the rewards of mass consumption. It is mistaken, however, to think that the architects of plenty came only from business and banking. Scientists and doctors developed the great life-saving cures, often with no profit to themselves beyond the satisfaction of aiding humanity. It was government, not private enterprise, that built the sewers and water systems that eradicated common illnesses and thus extended longevity. Government also built the roads and schools and financed technological development. Life-enhancing changes also were wrought by social reformers, from working-class labor organizers to the martyred advocates of racial equality to upper-class humanitarians, all morally angered by obvious injustices, pointless brutalities. And we also should mention the brave politicians who took up these social causes before they were in fashion, who coaxed business enterprise to behave more responsibly, and who finally compelled them to do so with new laws. All the while, the plain people struggled. Their stories usually got left out of the history texts since they are too diffuse to describe easily, too small and pedestrian as experiences of hope, defeat, triumph. When I consider the profusion of goods and recreational delights of our time, I think of my own grandfather, a Scotch-Irish farmer named Franklin S. McClure, whose well-ordered life now seems eccentric in its simplicity. Never rich, never poor, but moderately prosperous in their own terms, the McClures had farmed in the hill country of western Pennsylvania since the 1790s, an area established by revolutionary land grants, and the name had come to be well regarded in the vicinity. His lifetime was overtaken by the first waves of industrialization during the first half of the 20th century, overwhelmed by modern life. But he stood his ground, resisted what seemed frivolous to him, defended what seemed most valuable. I can still see an occasional puzzlement in his face as he contemplated the newness of things. Grandpa kept a small dairy herd and pasteurized his own milk, selling some to the coal miners' families living along the hollow. On 200 acres, half woodlands, he grew feed for the livestock and food for the family, maybe sold some grain when market prices were good. He never attended college, but read law books as the township's justice of the peace, and enjoyed a well-developed cultural life, music and classical literature, the Bible. He was self-sufficient unto his time and place, his sense of independence anchored in the fact that he owned his own land, managed and operated his own means of production. In 1900, when steel and coal were already booming along the Monongahela River Valley, this young farmer, my mother was a newborn, reported to a U.S. census taker that he was unemployed. So did the other neighboring farmers in Forward Township. They meant, I assume, that they worked for themselves, not for coal mines or steel mills or any other employer. As a child, when I spent summers on that farm, it was a living window on an already vanished past. For whatever reasons, never fully explained to us, my grandfather and grandmother declined to participate in the modernizing luxuries of their own era. Other farmers around him became mechanized, bought the first tractors and trucks, later the large threshing machines and combines. Grandpa continued to farm with his horses. He plowed and spread manure and harvested with horse-drawn implements, milked the cows by hand. When he grew too old to farm, he turned the horses out into the woods every day and leased the fields to neighbors with their machines and chemical fertilizers. The Center Hall farmhouse had no electricity, no telephone or plumbing. An indoor toilet and tub were installed once, but never functioned properly. Grandfather did decide once to install electricity at the farmhouse, but when grandmother saw the first poles marching up the lane, she objected. The wires ruined her view from the kitchen window, the gentle vista across fields and woods rising to a distant ridge dotted with white farmhouses, unpainted barns. She was strong-willed, too. He took down the poles. They lived on with gas lights and the icebox. I admire the stubbornness of their resistance, their willingness to stare down intrusions. But this is not a romantic lament for the lost simple life. The truth is, after a week or two on the farm, my brother and I would turn quarrelsome, tired of toting pails of water from the spring, sharing in hot field work, listening over and over to the same old phonograph records on the wind-up Victrola. We were bored silly by the simple life. We longed to return home to suburban civilization. In their own terms, however, this well-ordered life on the farm was not at all simple for my grandparents. Like most farmers, even today, my grandparents were, by necessity, workers with numerous skills. They knew animal husbandry, hogs, chickens, horses, cows, and horticulture, vegetables and fruit orchard, maple sugaring and crop rotation. They did carpentry, bookkeeping, occasional school teaching, mending and sewing. Grandma used to bake daily when she was younger, bread and fresh pies for breakfast. Grandpa was a machinist who fixed axles and other gear in his small blacksmith shop, though he never got the plumbing right. Though I never heard this said, my hunch is that what my grandparents resisted was the encroaching loss of self-reliance, the steadily vanishing complexity of their own self-contained lives, the capacity to do many things well and provide well enough for themselves. Put in those terms, it seems a huge and frightening loss. They were unwilling to accept the trade-offs. Their situation illustrates, first, How far the concept of economic necessity has traveled in two or three generations, and how greatly we have been liberated from hard daily labor by the fruits of industrial production. Yet, oddly enough, their sense of encroachment also parallels the modern experience. The new technologies of this era are much more complex, far too esoteric for common understanding, much less to repair at home, but the disorienting effects may be similar. In historical perspective, however, the technological changes of the present era, even the astonishing advances in telecommunications, do not involve life transformations as profound as what those earlier generations experienced. They were confronted by cars, airplanes, telephones, electric lights, indoor plumbing. Nor do the social and economic upheavals seem as severe for most of us, though they are still brutal for some. We can resist the machines, and many choose to do so, but we cannot blame them. Anyway, the machines are not going to go away because they do deliver, reliably, what many want in their lives, what people soon find they need. My digression into the distant past is intended to stimulate a little doubt and suspicion about our modern pretensions. Despite the progress of machines and money incomes, the fundamental terms of human existence do not change over time or even across centuries. See Ecclesiastes on this point. But we have perhaps forgotten some important elements of life that the ancestors readily understood. If the new technologies do not explain what is distinctive about the modern American condition, then we have to look elsewhere for an explanation of what agitates the social discontents and tensions. The answer is a breathtaking new fact of history, so simple and obvious one hesitates to announce it as news. The United States has solved the economic problem. America, that is, has solved the ancient economic problem known to all previous millennia of human toil. We have escaped the elemental struggle that has stalked human societies since the origins: hunger, scarcity, the burdens of producing enough for human survival, and a general standard of well-being that is not restricted to the powerful few, the king and high priests. The United States is not alone in this happy condition, but still the rare case in the world. The problem is solved. Yet the United States pushes on strenuously, like a long-distance runner who has won the race, yet keeps running beyond the finish line, not looking back, and not quite sure who or what drives him on. A similar observation arguably could have been made about the United States 30 or 40 years ago, but it would not have been taken seriously by a population that had lived through the sufferings of the Great Depression, or the deaths and sacrifices required by the mobilization for World War II. The point of overwhelming abundance is now plainly in our face and beyond argument, yet seldom discussed as the new central premise of the economic condition. The incompleteness at the core of American life, I believe, is also about this new fact of history. Our situation is unique. Learning how to live amid endless plenty, and ironically, how to live well in spite of it. Our ancestors never had to face such a struggle. We cannot escape it. In 1893, Samuel Gompers, the first president of the American Federation of Labor, was asked, "What does labor want?" "More," he answered. Of course, more. At the time, it sounded vaguely belligerent and greedy. Gompers' business adversaries used the one-word answer to demonize labor unions as a monstrous threat to civil order. But what organized labor sought, more, was merely the general ambition of all Americans and a deeply held objective of the nation. It still is. From the beginning, one could say more was the organizing principle for American life, the goal of immigrant sacrifices, the motivation for ferocious contests in economic life. It drove the expansion westward, pushing aside indigenous peoples who did not live by acquisitive precepts. It spawned great inventions. It justified the hard work and bountiful production. More is the bluntest expression of how we have defined the pursuit of happiness. Only during the last several generations have dissenting voices begun to articulate a different question: more of what? The question is answered easily and imaginatively. More of the old and more of the new. More cars and urban pickup trucks. more off-road vehicles for adventure, more and larger houses, and for some of us, two houses, or even three, more electronic connections worldwide, handheld, and 24/7, as tech hipsters say, more wealth, more food, more travel, more wilderness, more money, and more work, more sports channels, more movies, more miracle drugs, more ailments to be cured, more incinerators and landfills, more bottled water, more fat, more sugar, more lakes, more security guards, more toys. The chase of modern life can be exhilarating and gorgeously satisfying, also exhausting and terribly wasteful. One recalls the mordant bumper sticker that used to be seen on suburban pickup trucks. Whoever finishes with the most toys wins. All Americans across the differences of class and status, all but the very poor, achieved self-sufficiency in basic needs, food, shelter, clothing, and so forth, nearly a half century ago. At nearly every station and status level, most Americans share one way or the other in the common experience of plentiful consumption, notwithstanding the differences in content and volume. What could possibly be lacking? Time, most obviously. Americans on average work longer hours than their counterparts in other leading industrial economies, as much as 300 or 400 more hours per year. The pressures on time, combined with the need for rising incomes to maintain these patterns of consumption, undermine personal lives and family, but also deny any stable sense of fulfillment, given the erosion of job security, family savings, and pension rights. Indeed, for a broad swath of Americans who are not themselves poor, it sounds wildly wrong and offensive to talk about the extraordinary comfort levels of modern life. For them, the economic problem remains a month-to-month struggle of keeping up with the rent or mortgage payment. Statistics suggest a general affluence that is undeniable, yet they know and feel precariousness in their condition. Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan expressed his own puzzlement when he discovered that levels of anxiety and insecurity seemed to be rising inversely to the supposedly healthy conditions of the economy. As recently as 1981, in the depths of recession, international survey research found 12% of workers fearful of losing their jobs, Greenspan told the American Council on Education in early 1999. In today's tightest labor market in two generations, the same organization found 37% concerned about job loss. How could this be so? Plausible explanations are not exactly a secret. They start with the rigorous new style of management that adjusts to transient fevers from financial markets by discarding long-experienced and well-paid employees. This helps the stock price while it sows doubts and fears in the society. For a time, the rising price bubble in stock markets was thought to be an antidote to these rising insecurities, the way in which even small investors could accumulate sufficient assets to make their lives secure for the distant future. A TV commercial for Scudder Investments adroitly captured the ironic tensions embedded in contemporary prosperity. What if you want to stop working for a living? What if you want to start living for a living? The new passion for stock market investments became an alluring kind of substitute for many people, a defense against the pressures on family, an escape from the immediate worries. It was not to be. When the bubble burst, American households swiftly lost $3 or $4 trillion in putative wealth. The mutual funds where they had parked their savings fell back to the same levels of 4 or 5 years earlier, before share prices had begun their great but temporary inflation. The illusions were deeply felt, however. A popular financial guru for middle-class investors, Susie Orman, instructed her followers, "Money is a living entity, and it responds to energy exactly the way you do. It is drawn to those who welcome it, those who respect it." Her insight sounds plain wacky now that stock prices have collapsed, despite the sincere devotion of share owners. In my grandfather's time, describing money as a living entity would have been regarded as blasphemy. His financial balance sheet was trivial compared to modern standards of personal wealth. Yet somehow he was able to feel more secure and more independent despite his relative poverty. This is not a trivial anomaly, but the new paradox created by America's extraordinary abundance. Most Americans, I am convinced, have at least a vague sense that something is wrong in the contours of their supposed prosperity. In my experience, I do not find these complaints restricted to the poor or struggling working class, though their struggles are obviously more stark and often desperate. In affluent living rooms, one hears the same conversations about stress and disappointment, the same exasperation and futility, often laced with an edgy bitterness toward those who are supposed to be in charge. Despite the class differences, I have heard people from nearly every income level express an oddly similar sense of confinement, as if their lives were trapped by the good times rather than liberated. Short of renouncing modern life and going off to live in the woods, they do not see any sure way to break free of what binds them. Think of the paradox as enormous and without precedent in history. A fabulously wealthy nation in which plentiful abundance may also impoverish our lives. Even the cycles of rising prosperity can begin to feel tyrannical. As each new generation of products and subsequent upgrades appears, the context surrounding one's circumstances is altered, and there's no easy escape. A family may decide to keep its food in an icebox, but where do they buy the block of ice? One does not actually need a television for entertainment, but without one you are utterly lost in office conversations. Some people do opt for the simple life and clear away the gadgets and unnecessary complexities. A virtuous choice, surely, though not one I would choose. Character and values can guide people toward wiser choices, but neither individuals nor the society can easily escape the present system because the principles of more are everywhere. More is embedded in the behavior of every business enterprise and the principles of marketing, in the self-interested decisions of every investor and consumer. The pursuit of more guides politics and government policy and describes the core objective of formal economics. Faith in more, as a blunt instrument for achieving the greater good for the greatest number, is what legitimizes the confinements and social distress from families to communities. It does require real character to step back and question what others regard as natural law. The British economist John Maynard Keynes, who was wise about the human condition as well as money matters, predicted this dilemma of plenty more than 70 years ago in an essay entitled, "The Economic Possibilities for Our Grandchildren." Capitalism, Keynes observed, was generating surplus wealth for investment at such a rapid pace that, combined with scientific discovery and sound engineering, the process of wealth creation should eventually eradicate the ancient afflictions of human want and material suffering. This, he thought, could occur for the advanced countries within 100 years, notwithstanding occasional setbacks from war or depression. At the point of triumph, Keynes declared, people would at last be free, truly free of the old fears and struggles, but would then face the larger, more permanent questions of mortal existence. What does it mean to be truly human? For the first time since his creation, Keynes wrote, man will be faced with his real, his permanent problem, how to use his freedom from pressing economic cares, how to occupy his leisure, which science and compound interest have won for him, to live wisely and agreeably and well. America clearly has arrived at the threshold Keynes described. There is plenty to go around, more than enough for everyone by any reasonable measure. Yet the accomplishment does not prompt great celebration, because, as everyone knows, the overflowing abundance is obvious in the economic data, but not in the society. 1/6 of the population, the government reports, still lacks the means to provide even the minimum essentials of food and shelter for themselves. By official measure, 1/5 of America's children live in this old-fashioned condition of poverty. Yet the burdens of inequality are spread more broadly than that and are more central to the discontents amid the abundance. Amartya Sen, a Nobel Prize-winning economist, has described a more supple social definition of poverty that is more relevant to our condition. Poverty, he suggests, is when people lack the means to appear in public without shame. By that standard, many more Americans are impoverished than the government has calculated. And Sen's definition perhaps captures the real inner dynamic driving mass consumption beyond acquiring the basic necessities. It is not simply a matter of keeping up with the Joneses or mimicking refined tastes. The consumption is required to keep up with American life itself. To avoid experiencing public shame in this society, a family needs far more than food and shelter, and whatever personal desires one feels, the marketing mechanisms of commerce continuously re-elaborate the social definition of what more means. Looking backward, one can say that the mass consumption society constructed during the 20th century was an egalitarian triumph in the sense that nearly all were enabled to participate, albeit at vastly different levels of luxury. But the future of mass consumption is now, paradoxically, threatened by the growing inequalities of wealth and incomes. As Claire Brown, an economist at the University of California, Berkeley, reported, a large portion of Americans, mainly in the laborer and wage-earner classes, is now faltering, diverging in their consumption patterns from the better-off classes. This fissuring of the middle class, first noted with alarm in the 1980s, is driven basically by the diverging fortunes of American families in personal wealth and the widening gulfs in incomes. People, to put it crudely, don't have enough money to keep up. Nevertheless, they are trying, struggling heroically, one might say, to remain good consumers and thus avoid the public shame. From the 1950s to the early 1970s, Brown explained, virtually all classes enjoyed a robust expansion in their discretionary spending on variety and status consumption. Even the poor gained a much improved standard of living, thanks to more generous public subsidies. However, during the last three decades, as hourly wages stagnated in real terms, working families were squeezed in their ability to maintain an expanding participation in the mass consumption. They more or less succeeded, though at a steadily slowing pace. How did they accomplish this? First, they worked harder and longer, mainly with women, wives, and mothers entering the full-time workforce and other family members taking on part-time jobs. Second, they borrowed against their savings, with credit cards and lines of bank credit that steadily drew down the accumulated equity they owned in their homes. This process explains the mountainous debt levels households built up amid the booming 90s. After storing up savings through home ownership during the 60s and 70s, the average homeowner drew down home equity dramatically during the last two decades, from 70% to 51% of mortgage value. The problem with both of these strategies, working longer hours, spending the family savings, is that neither can be repeated during the next 20 years. Sooner or later, people will run out of time to take on another job or additional overtime shifts. Sooner or later, they will run out of savings. An economic crunch seems unavoidable unless the distribution of incomes is altered significantly. When this reckoning occurs in sufficient numbers, the normal assumptions of our mass consumption economy should be severely challenged, as broad ranks of working people are compelled to change their values as consumers, to get by with less and endure the social shame. Professor Brown is not sanguine about how this rancorous transition will unfold. Continued wage stagnation will eventually translate into stagnation of living standards, she predicts. In the absence of a major transformation of social values, our class conflicts over income and what it buys can be expected to intensify. In those circumstances, Americans might at last be compelled to reconsider the underlying economic assumptions of more. The internal logic of economic theory is derived, after all, from the historic expectation of permanent scarcity, scarcity confronted by infinite potential for human needs and wants. Thus, capitalism ingeniously strives to produce more output from less input, the efficiency that demands, according to its own definitions, the most effective allocation of resources and capital. The assumption that scarcity is with us always claims the highest priority in public affairs and efficiency regularly trumps social aspirations. An impossible burden of proof confronts intangible social goals that are not marketable commodities and thus have no priced value. What is the rate of return? How much might this social improvement damage the production of more? Both liberals and conservatives accept these efficiency premises. Their policy arguments in macroeconomics are generally over the best way to achieve the more. The standard assumptions of efficiency, however, are regularly mocked by real-life outcomes. The faith in efficiency was shaken most recently by the horrendous disintegration of stock prices that destroyed somewhere between $6 and $8 trillion in capital, including especially the retirement savings of working families. The financial system's managers shrugged this off as an unfortunate occurrence and lamely explained that these things are to be expected in the tides of free market capitalism. The House of Economics is due for major renovations, if not a complete teardown, because the economic order has lost one of its main emotional suppositions, the motivating fear of scarcity and deprivation. The dread of scarcity lives on, however, in public consciousness, in law and politics and civic ambitions. As people come to terms with this new condition, and there is scattered evidence that some young people are asking themselves, more of what? Many fruitful questions about the future are opened for discussion. What now justifies the harsh personal sacrifices imposed on people's lives in the name of sustaining the abundance? Why does the capitalist process continue to defend or ignore its many forms of social injury, especially the ecological destruction, when the pursuit of accumulation is no longer a matter of human survival, but more often an elaboration of surplus? If there is plenty to go around, as there clearly is, why does the economic order still require a permanent subcategory of the impoverished and dependent, Marx's famous reserve army of the unemployed? For that matter, why must society accept a capitalism that persists in generating greater inequalities, generation after generation, as the required terms for sustaining general abundance? If ever greater concentrations of wealth and power are the inescapable result of our economic system, then what future is there for ever achieving genuine democracy in place of an elite plutocracy? These matters, and other systemic disorders, usually are blamed on people, on human error or weakness, on the failure of schooling or the political system or society itself. The only remedy, we are assured, is achieving still more. Many Americans no longer believe this. Skeptics are found especially among those who see the ongoing ecological destruction as the most critical contradiction overshadowing our prosperity. This historical moment allows us, in fact impels us, to look directly at the engine itself, that is, at the nature of American capitalism. The purpose of this program is to examine more deeply how and why our brilliant economic system collides with so many of society's broader aspirations and regularly frustrates them. Our objective is to identify the functional routines and relationships within the system itself that might be altered, in fact, must be altered, in order to achieve the more fulfilling society that ought to be possible now, given our great wealth. The idea of reinventing American capitalism sounds far-fetched, I know, and especially improbable considering the market-centered orthodoxy that reigns in conventional thinking. I can report, nevertheless, that many Americans are already at work on the idea in various scattered ways, though usually not with such sweeping declarations of intent. They are experimenting in localized settings, tinkering with the ways in which the system operates, and are convinced that alternatives are possible, not utopian schemes, but self-interested and practical changes that can serve broader purposes. This approach seems quite remote from the current preoccupations of big politics and big business, but this is where the society's deepest reforms usually have originated in the American past. The future may begin among ordinary people, far distant from established power, who are brave enough to see themselves as pioneers. The soul of capitalism. The big fundamental questions have all been answered, or so we are told. Continuing disputes among economists or business and political leaders typically involve the subsidiary issues of how best to manage things for maximum output and efficiency. The economic system is marvelously well-developed, sophisticated, and intimidatingly complex, and one does not doubt it is the great engine of our abundance. In these circumstances, society itself seems becalmed. At least, people are not mobilized by any great causes challenging the existing order. Most citizens, either because they are contented with things or resigned to fate, have essentially withdrawn from the arena of political action, perhaps sensing that politics has nothing larger in mind for them or no intention of addressing their personal discontents. America, meanwhile, describes itself to the world in unblushing superlatives: the richest, freest, most powerful and capable nation on earth. Indeed, this is what we tell ourselves. Notwithstanding the settled stillness, this program proceeds from an opposite premise, that a more contentious time is approaching, when big questions about American economic life are back on the table again for serious reconsideration. Not overnight, perhaps, or with any dramatic announcements, but the deeper rhythms of the national story are pushing us toward a renewal of doubt and questioning, a skeptical re-examination of long-accepted arrangements in American capitalism that govern life and work and enterprise. This agitating inquiry will occur not for ideological reasons, but because the practical necessities of everyday life and the country's unfulfilled aspirations gradually persuade more and more citizens that something in our system is seriously out of whack and ought to be changed, even if they cannot identify exactly what is wrong or how it might be corrected. Someday hence, if my premise is right, Americans will be talking again about the fundamentals, asking themselves if it is possible to alter the system in various ways and how they might proceed. We will be arguing anew, for instance, over the terms and conditions of work, and about the ways in which investment and production are organized. We may ask ourselves why the decision-making in important institutions of business and finance is so closely held among a relative few, when their decisions have such great impact on our lives at work and at home. We may explore more rigorously how our savings are deployed as investment capital, and whether the results are pleasing or alarming. Indeed, why does the economic system seem so indifferent, even hostile, to the intangibles in life that have the deepest meaning for people and society? We might even ask ourselves, what is the meaning of wealth now that America is so awesomely wealthy? Our subject is the nature of American capitalism and how it organizes life for us and for society at large. Why it generates great injury and destructive consequences right alongside the material abundance. This program is not intended as another bleak catalog of those consequences. The social dislocations and gross wastefulness, the confinements on personal liberties and enduring injustices, the inequalities and the ecological destruction. I expect most listeners are familiar one way or another with the deleterious impact of capitalism on lives or community, but they may also feel largely powerless to do much about it. Furthermore, I suspect many Americans, including among the affluent, experience a vague sense of personal shame because they regularly encounter conflicts between their own values and human aspirations and the imperatives of the economic system, conflicts they are unable to resolve. They either do not earn enough to live well, in material terms, or they earn more and more, yet still find themselves unable to live well in human terms. Unable to find fulfillment in their material circumstances, some reluctantly accept the incompleteness as a sign of personal failure. The hunger is unnamed and embarrassing to acknowledge, but seems part of the price one is obliged to pay, part of what the system expects or demands. These peculiar consequences of modern prosperity are examined in order to get to the larger question: why does it have to be this way? Are Americans inevitably consigned to a series of dispiriting trade-offs between their lives and values and social obligations, on one hand, and the demands of gorgeous, beckoning abundance? Or might people instead actually change the nature of American capitalism? This program offers a very hopeful story of the possible, one that tells how our society can alter the operating values of capitalism instead of the other way around, and thus can establish basic human needs and aspirations as the dominant force in our economic life. That promise suggests people are not as powerless as they imagine, and in fact, they are not. As I will explain, Americans have the potential, collectively, to acquire decisive influence over large questions of business and finance that are now decided remotely by a limited number of powerful institutions. If that sounds excessively optimistic, given the present dominance of business values, remember that profound systemic changes are not made quickly or easily. But the supporting evidence will show that many efforts toward transformation have already begun. My premise, that American capitalism is ripe for reinvention, is not based on fanciful supposition. The most compelling reason for expecting deep reform is the new circumstance described earlier, the paradox of secure abundance accompanied by the stressed social reality. We are on new ground as a country, yet neither the operating assumptions nor the governing institutions have been adjusted to conform. The absence of profound adjustments promises to raise the threshold of collateral pain until sooner or later, for better or worse, the system's operating assumptions are changed, or society becomes resigned to the new, starker version of inequality that is emerging. A second reason is that, until rather recently, the very idea of transforming the terms of American capitalism was regarded as a taboo subject. During the Cold War decades, questioning the functional realities of the U.S. system sounded vaguely subversive, as if maybe you were working for the other side. Then the Cold War ended, and an ideological contest with communism that had stretched across 150 years was abruptly, definitively resolved. Capitalism won. State-owned economies disintegrated. This event swept away stale ideological baggage on both sides and opened new political space. The first opportunity in half a century to ask bigger questions about capitalism itself, how it works or fails to work on behalf of the general society. This new space remains largely unfilled as yet, but I seek, at a minimum, to show people that it's now okay to think and talk critically about capitalism's own shortcomings. At this point in history, it may even be the patriotic thing to do. There are good reasons why capitalism has prevailed across 5 or 6 centuries, while alternative economic systems faltered and eventually failed. To understand the American system's blind spots and how they might be overcome, one must also appreciate its enduring strengths. It produces more from less, more reliably than other systems did. Its processes are also always forward-looking and constantly adapting to new circumstances, thus always progressive, according to its own objectives. These qualities are not self-evident to social critics who focus on the system's stubborn destructiveness, but the operating techniques of capitalism involve a kind of continuous flexibility, evolving to meet new conditions and threats. On the margins, inventive dissenters are always trying to do things differently, more profitably, and when those firms succeed, others will rush to emulate them. This fluid ability to adapt probably explains, as well as anything, why the communist systems could not keep up with the capitalist reality. This flexibility also helps explain why the system is more vulnerable to change than it appears. Some of the positive reforms I will describe actually are underway within the system itself, crucial experiments that already are succeeding in visible ways, though still ignored or belittled in conventional practice. Furthermore, as we examine the internal routines that produce so much collateral damage, it will become clear that many of the institutional arrangements and operating principles in the American system are utterly outmoded. Most were devised a century ago, more or less for circumstances that no longer exist, either in the economy or society, yet they continue in place. If these arrangements were perhaps once justifiable, they exist now only as convenient fictions, disguising the power relationships that serve certain narrow interests, but effectively deprive the general population of any voice or influence, even over their own money. Knowledge is power. This deformity cannot survive if enough people come to understand its meaning. The process of self-education is underway. Above all, I have considerable confidence that the new subject is reforming capitalism itself, because I have seen so many Americans already engaged in the challenge one way or another. You will meet some of them in this program. They are a scattered and eclectic lot, mostly operating beneath the media's attention, and not yet taken seriously by the citadels of business and financial power. Many are even unaware of parallel efforts by kindred spirits elsewhere. It would be premature to describe them as a movement to reinvent capitalism, since none yet exists. At this point, their activities are no more than interesting fragments. Big ideas, small isolated triumphs, the seeds perhaps of something larger. These are the people I think of as the pioneers, the risk-takers in our time trying to open up new territory within our highly elaborated economic system. What they have in common is a shared sensibility, and some level of active anger, about how important social imperatives and cherished aspects of the human experience are being ground up by the economic system, which is largely oblivious to the destruction. Prosperity, they insist, does not require that it has to be this way, and indeed, people cannot long endure this version of prosperity. Many of them speak only of concrete projects, not grand pronouncements about altering capitalism, and have engaged themselves in a long and undramatic process of practical experiments and purposeful tinkering to discover what works, what doesn't. Many are occasionally derided as dreamers or crackpots, yet they see themselves, much as the pioneers did, as down-to-earth pragmatists, trying to fashion something new and replenishing out of this era's conflicted prosperity. It does sound audacious, setting out to change the value system of capitalism on behalf of society. The contemporary culture ignores this tedious, slow-moving route to progress. But American history confirms that the most important social and economic transformations have always originated in this humble fashion. The reform objectives were sustained at first by ordinary people with nerve and conviction long before the leaders embraced their ideas. Starting small and localized.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.